I don't care if you're ready, we're going for it. Hello and welcome to the Real Filthy Podcast, the most inconsistently consistent podcast on the internet. I'm your host Harry, and as usual with me is my co-host Gary. Give us a wave, Gary.
What is that photo, man? What is going on?
Do you like it?
I thought the whole Cthulhu angle was kind of weird, but this is even weirder, man. Come on, camera.
I made it especially for today. If you're not going to like it, I'm going to turn it off.
Face review.
Hello.
There he is.
Well, Real Filthy Harry, we're back after 2 years. I was talking to Brycey. When was it we done that episode with John McPhail and Douglas King? Was it 2019 or something?
When was that? Yeah, 2018.
When I got my parking ticket for parking the wrong car. On the app. What was that all about?
Well, lots happened since then, hasn't it? But no more episodes of Real Filthy Podcast have happened since then, so...
Well, no, we did do the Rock episode. We did need to talk about The Rock, so that's what's brought us back. So
yeah, that was a... Should we introduce our guest, Gary, or are we just going to keep chatting?
No, I'm just going to talk about The Rock first. But anyway, we've got our esteemed guests and friends of the show, Paul Morris and James Price. How are you doing, guys?
Very good.
Thank you so much for having us, man. I appreciate it.
No bother. So, Paul Morris is the director of Angry Young Men, which is going to be at Glasgow Film Festival, debut feature. And we've got James Price as well. He's done Boys Night, Spiral. He's got Skint coming out at the festival, so which stars Peter Mullen. So let's talk about that first, Pricey. What was that like, working with the legend that is Peter Mullen?
That was amazing, man. I was actually last time I was in here, I kind of knew it was about to happen, but I wasn't allowed to talk about it. So I told the story on Gary's Glasgow podcast, just about my initial meeting there, Peter, and how nice he was to me. I know, it was unbelievable, man. Absolute legend. Like, just such a nice guy, such a professional. You know, it was overwhelming. Just really, really, just too cool. Just still doesn't feel real, even though it's happened. What a legend, man. Can he sing his praises highly enough, man? He brought it and elevated what was an alright script to something really special. So yeah, I'm indebted to him forever now.
So what was his involvement then? Was he just acting in it, or was he kind of producing as well?
So he was a directing mentor on it. So he was kind of in the production of it as well. And Lisa McGee, who does Daddy Girl, she was like the writer mentor. So was the main reason I thought I could get him, to be honest. That's why I wrote it with him in mind, because I thought he's involved in this thing. Like, majority of other writers are for England, so I was like, if I'm going to write for Peter Mullen and see if he'll say aye. And
just slap it in front of him, like, going to just say it.
That's kind of what we did, and I waited on the answer, and then he came back and said aye, and I was mind-blown, man. Time's just zoomed by since. I was so nervous about it, and like, on the run-up to it, and then it just all happened.
No, my mind was blown when you sent us that DM, man, because I knew he was your idol. Like,
100%. I know, it's so strange. Yeah, I definitely... Yeah, it's like, that's the thing, man. It's the reason that I'm doing this. Like, Close, Fridge, Orphans, at least Orphans in particular. Like, if I didn't see the films at a young age, I don't think I'd have had the thought or the guts to get a bash here in Glasgow. It's all his fault, really.
Don't shoot me, mate, but I know you've went on about Orphans to me quite a bit, but we actually just watched it recently. My Name Is Joe was always the big
one for me,
but Orphans, amazing, man.
Masterpiece, man.
Probably go see that show as well. You seen that?
I'm going to go see it with Florence, man.
I'm excited to see it.
Paul, you've been doing a bit of a press tour for the likes of things, man. I know all the papers on BBC Radio and stuff like that. How's that been going?
It's been good, mate. It's I was saying to Pricey there that I was in my bed at 6 o'clock last night. I don't know why, I'm not doing anything, but it does take out your wee bits when you're talking to folks. You know yourself, man. It's like, I don't know why, it's not anything that's strenuous, but I've been quite tired just trying to stay on top of it, and also just trying to, like, even if things aren't actually happening, you're sort of a lot of anticipation. So I don't know if it's just like stress, but I'm not a stressed guy, but like, it must be that. Like, I'm just worrying about how it's going to be taken, how it's going to be received. And just all the possible outcomes and walkouts and people demanding their money back. No, but I don't think there will be, but
that's not going to happen. Don't be mad.
Kind of worry, but the good thing is, if the festival accepted it, the boys liked it. I mean, they can be, you can be like the worst critics in the best way. You know, your mates are like the closest people could say stuff like that to you, but they all seem really keen, and my missus is really keen on it. Nicola, she really liked it. So hopefully it'll be all good. But the press stuff's been brilliant.
Ah, good. Nah, I'll be packing the spoons for the premiere mate to chuck at you for the front row.
Have you heard the Benwell story and what he did? Like, see the, what's it called? Leishin and Andalus, you know, when they're cutting of the eye. Have you seen that? It's like the big famous old short, him and Salvador Dali did.
Yep.
Apparently, like, he thought that was dead, like, avant-garde and at the time, and then Paris, they screened it, and he thought everybody's going to hate it. All these mad middle class cinema goers were going to hate it. So he had a bag of rocks behind the screen and he was ready to throw them at the audience when he started doing them. But they liked it. So it was all good. But I won't do that. But I'm on edge.
Nah, let's do that. Let's bring a bag of stones. And if the audience says anything, we whack them.
Concealed weapon, mate. We Swiss Army knife or something.
100%.
So what's been the, have you been getting a few reactions for people then so far before the film, and people interviewing you, have people watched it, stuff like that so far?
It's strange because we did that the Janice Forsyth show, and I thought it was going to be like the other interviews where they sort of just read your press kit and they go, so how was it made? So I was kind of ready to go in and just sort of talk about that, but then she played like a clip of the intro and I wasn't expecting it, and then she started talking about scenes in the film that aren't in the trailer. And I was like, oh, you've seen it? And then she was like quite complimentary about it. And I was like, oh, that's brilliant. But I've not really heard anyone else. And I don't know, it's like a secret of that. I don't know if they said that to you as well. It's like they put an embargo on reviews until like an hour after your premiere. I didn't know if you knew that.
That's cool.
Yeah, so if it's your premiere,
yeah.
At the time it's screened, it's like an hour after. So I think the press, there's like the festival screenings, but then there's like an industry platform. I think you probably know a bit about that as well. And it's like ours is on like the 5th of March. So all the industry people that want to see it will see it then, write their reviews, and then they have to wait an hour to post it. So I don't really know anyone's reaction because nobody's really allowed to talk about it. So
how does that feel? How does that feel to have to wait for that reaction even longer?
It's hard because in some ways you've already sort of won being in the fest. Do you mean like that's sort of like the kind of main goal and see you have in front of an audience? Like that feels like an achievement already, but you also do want people to react positively to it. So I'm hoping that it'll have a good reaction, but at the same time, it's like, I don't know, and not maybe be naive, but I think there'll be a certain amount of brownie points because of how it was made. Do you know what I mean? Like, I think they will be kinder, but I'm not expecting it to be like 5 stars for nothing or whatever. Do you mean? But I hope it's a good reaction, but you just don't know. So just maybe that's adding to the stress, just the anticipation of that, but we'll see.
Me and Harry were talking about this the other day. How long has this actually been in the works? Because I'm pretty sure when we had you on, when we first started this back in like, I'm sure it was like 2017 or something. So was it then? Was it 2017, 2018 that I'd spoke to you? And you'd just done the script, I think, at that point. But
I think we'd done the script and what we'd shot one scene. Because I was on 2018, I think it was summer 2018 I was on, in the old digs in the uni.
Aye.
So that'd been 2 years writing, and then we'd shot the first scene, and then it was 3 years and a day shooting.
Aye. We've archived a lot of that stuff, but I did listen back to that episode the other week. I don't know if you did, Harry, but it's just quite interesting listening back to just see how far it's come in that time. Obviously, it's been a few years, but like just for that point, like reading the script, just everything's just come together, man. Like a lot of people just have these sort of dreams of making a first feature and no actual day in it. It just kind of gets put in the back burner, but you've actually went out and done it, man, so fair play, man.
No, 100%, that's the main thing I need to say, just total admiration. Like, me and Gary, we make short films, and short films are kind of, you're making films for other filmmakers to watch. Like, the dream is to have the guts to just go and do a feature, and you did it, man, and that's a beautiful thing, man. Like, you should be proud of yourself.
What did that feel like when you did call Final Cut on this project? They've been going for three years in the making.
I think because you all know any project you've got, it's on your mind every single day, like what you're going to do next, how it's going to be received. So it's been part of my life for probably like 5 years. And even before I sat down to write it, I was thinking about an idea to write, you know what I mean? So it's probably been longer than that, walking about Fairhill and Woodhead with the camera and thinking about shots and all that. But it just feels like something that's part of your life. So it's strange to not have it, even though I'm still doing promo stuff. So it's still kind of part of that. But it just feels like something you had to do every day. So, but then saying that, when I finished shooting, I'd already edited a good chunk in the second lockdown, so I was editing, so it never really stopped. So even in that sense, it was done. One aspect was done, but I was still doing like sound design. I was still writing the score and all that. So it was still like you were in it for a good way. Well, even now you're still in it because nobody's seen it yet officially. So I don't know, but I'm excited to take on the next one and see how that goes. But you just hope. I mean, I said this to you and I've said it to like so many people. It's like you just hope that it leads to something that you can get like a proper funded like feature, because it's almost like what else do you need to prove? Because it's no like a. This isn't in like any a disrespectful way, but it's almost like what do you need to do for somebody to go like that boy needs money for a feature? Because I'm like fucking ever since I met Pricey in 2016. When did you shoot Drop Me Off Michael? 2015? No,
it came out in 2015. They shot it in 2014. It came out in 2015.
If that had been an American short or an English short, you would have got a feature off the back of that, 100%.
I appreciate you saying that, man. That means a lot. I know. Genuinely, that's what I think I've said it to you before, but genuinely, when I made that, I thought that was it. I thought, look, I was going to be in the Scottish Illuminati. It was going to be all these parties, and, I thought I'd be pals with Peter Mullen back again. And then nothing happened. You know what I mean? Nothing happened. I realised, I need to start making more shorts, or else people are going to forget about me.
But now, even look at the sort of, if you look, to give somebody, like, here's the shorts, and you're to say, right, here's Drop Me Off Michael, here's Spiral, here's Boys Night. It's almost like, right, everyone loves it. They're so well made, so well written. It's authentic Glasgow. It's and even fucking Infectious Nihilism.
Well, thank you so much. So good.
Honestly, I can't sing the praises of that enough. If you were to give that to anyone, I mean, I'm not no disrespect to like American directors or British directors, but when you see like what they did as a calling card and then became like their feature film at Sundance and all that.
It's true, definitely. It feels like we all need to work harder here to get your foot in the door. It's a strange thing.
There's a lot of factors. A lot of it is just seems to be luck though.
Well, definitely.
You can have all the talent and all that, but you kind of need to be in the right place at the right time as well.
Definitely.
Put it in the right person's hands to finance it, I suppose. But just going off of that a wee minute ago, you were mentioning meeting in 2016. I totally forgot about that, actually. How did you both meet?
I'd like Paul to go first on this, because I want to know the initial first meeting. Like, what was it? It was Glasgow first one? Yeah.
So it was a TV thing called The Network, and the initial, it's like you apply for everything. Do you mean anything that's going to say potential in the industry, to get you a job in the industry? So we went to that, and it was quite a big group. I think it was maybe like 60 people, maybe.
It was a decent amount of people, definitely.
Diverse group of people. People feel like Ireland and all was in the group. All kind of varying ages. But we went in and we're in the key, and then they're sort of having like wee workshop with that, and then we get put in a workshop together, and it was like, come up with a kid's show or something like that.
That's right, that's what it was. Aye, I do remember, that's right.
And you're like a cross feature, and you're like, right, People are watching you, and you know, I've said this to you, and I've said it to other people who've contacted me, being in the network and all that, and they're saying, like, how does it go? And it's such a bizarre, like, feeling an experience, because you're having to show how good you are, but also how nice you are and how well you work with other people. So you're trying to one-up each other and, like, cut each other's throat, but you're also trying to show, it's like, by the way, I'm so good in a group. So we did that, and it was like, I was like, right, I just need to speak, because you need to show you made some contribution. And I was like, right, okay, it's a kid's show. I'm thinking like bright colours or something like that. And then Price was like, aye, and then this, and then we just, and I was like, fuck, an ally, man. Like, right, okay, we're in. And then we met again, like the second one of that in London. And I saw him in like the lobby of Google. I was like, oh, thank fuck, man. And I was like, how are you doing? Because like, right, you're in London, just yourself, got the sleeper down there.
Yep.
And you're just like, right, okay. And then we just started chatting away. And then we cut about, like, it was brilliant, man. It's like one of my favourite times, like, cutting about London. We walked from Google to the BFI.
We did. I remember vividly. I remember my mom gave me 50 quid. I go to Boston in a suit. Get at that point, hey, I wasn't sure who I was, you know what I mean? Like, I was like, I'm a filmmaker. So I remember I was wearing some sort of suit, weren't I? Like,
you were dressed sharp, man.
I was dressed sharp. I remember I went down the suit, the bus down in the suit, got off the bus, and then walked to Google, nearly got knocked down off a moped. That's vivid, because I'd wake up with nightmares about that, like, that moped could have killed me. And then I remember seeing Paul, friendly face. And then I remember just walking about London, man. I remember vividly seeing the guy playing with the traffic cones. Do you remember that?
We're in Covent Garden, right? And I says, I'm like, look at this cunt. And this guy was just sitting with a traffic cone. I'll put this away, everyone. And he just was like, singing a song in a traffic cone, and we're just like that, looking like fucking.
Don't get this in Glasgow, man. This is beautiful. And then the other thing that kept happening was this is like a crown I've got here, and it kept falling out, and I looked like a. I looked bad, man, and Paul was so nice and just like kept ignoring it, and I'm like stuffing my teeth back in my face like every 2 seconds. And I remember that we went to BFI and I bought the Eyes Wide Shut script that the wee book bit outside, and I've still got that script, man. I'd like but that was a beautiful time, man. That was like, it was, and it was really, because it was at that point here, but it's like, I feel like there's a magic in like that point when you've got like nothing but dreams, man. there's something really beautiful about that. And
because we just walked. It must have been like 4 hours. Well,
it was a decent day, 100%. It was a decent episode of five. Holy, like, we walked across London, man.
Talked about everything. The Wire. Yep. Talked about, like, I remember we even spoke about like how, like, what's the best way to make us? Because we hadn't seen anything. I hadn't seen Drop Me Off Michael yet. I only saw it after our meeting. And we're talking about how these films or how Scottish stuff should be made. And we're like, there's a tendency to make it quite like tartan and shortbread, and it's like, but that's like, it can be Scottish without being like, too, like, here's a Scottish package. Do you know what I mean? And we spoke about that.
We did, yeah, definitely.
Went through it all, but honestly, see this, I keep going back there, and I don't know a lot of it to do with that trip. And there's I love the South Bank, so you've been down there, next to the BFI. It's something like magic about it, like just going down there and all the wee bookstalls, and it was phenomenal.
It also reminds me of you. So that was my first time there. This also reminds me of you, man. Nice, beautiful, man. That was a magical time. Like, some madness.
But we stayed in touch after that. But I mean, it's hard to believe that's like 6 years, because it does feel like it's went in a flash. No, but that's how we met. That's how we initially got together.
So was that the going down the bus in the suit? Was that the magical £5 mega bus you were on?
Oh, I think it was a wee bit dear on that, but I basically, man, I remember it was uncomfortable. Right. I'm not going to lie. I did it for the first time since last year, because I forgot how bad it was. And then last year I remembered, I was like, oh, you don't do this, man. So you just pay the money, get the train.
You get boomers being like, get the Wades back into national service and that. I feel like everybody needs to experience the megabus, the £5 megabus Glasgow to London. That's like a proper test of the world.
Definitely.
A train to London should be £50 max.
100%, definitely.
Flights are cheaper than it, it's insane.
It's nuts, it's absolutely nuts.
Welcome to the Real Filthy Podcast, the transport podcast. that's brilliant. But man, it's interesting hearing about programs like that, though, the talent network, where, you know, they're almost kind of marketed as like, oh, you'll get into, there's a career path to being a writer director. And I done the whole classic thing where the classic education, went and done a film degree. Like, I spoke to you about that, Paul. You didn't go that route. You've just made stuff. But I went into that kind of green eyed, like, oh, you do that, then there's like a progression. You run people's coffee, then you become an AD, a third AD, then you become a second, blah, blah, blah. Once you've been an AD, you're a director. But it's the more people that have actually been in the industry that I've spoke to, it's like, doesn't it actually work like that? But that's what that's what you're taught in these kind of courses. It's like, oh yeah, you can be a runner, and because, I don't know, like Chris Nolan done that or something like that, or like, I'm sure he
did. Fincher did it as well.
Yeah, well, he was a music video director, but the thing that people miss out of that is it's like he was directing stuff. So that's the career path to be the director is,
and he was,
make
he was
stuff.
A, he was a like a graphics design genius as well, was he not? His business was turning over millions in LA before he was like 25 or something like that. In fact, was he not? I'm sure he started as a runner for Industrial Light and Magic, and then he was the top graphic designer or something in a couple of years. So I mean, so you can't compare. But even look at someone that we know. I don't know if you've not met Kieran. Have Kieran Smith?
I've got him on social media. I don't know if I think I might have met him once. I'm not positive.
We'll meet at the premiere 100%. But he's one of his stories is he was working on Outlander, and he's been a runner for a good while, and he's done a good few shows. Mm-hmm. And that was his thing, that like you start in and maybe you could get your way up to like an AD and all that. But he was working like mad shifts, and even though it's like Cumbernauld as a studio, there's a Warwick or something it's called. He was traveling to Fife. Yeah. He was traveling to Fife like every day.
Jeez.
And he was traveling out, and he was coming from Glasford, which is pretty much like Straven End, so it's a good trek. He was doing it every morning, you know, working a set. It's like 12-hour days and then driving out. And one morning he fell asleep at the wheel and like wrote his car off, and luckily he was okay. But then he went to work, and then he basically just says, okay. And then at lunchtime, they eventually let him away, and he was like, fuck this. And it's maybe you'd say, oh, you need to do it for 10 or 15 years, but then it's almost like they're not going to say, right, you're a great runner. Do you want to get behind the camera?
No,
you need to have something to show, which I think is the bottom line. I said that to a guy for like a uni paper, was gave us a career interview recently, and he was saying like, what's the advice and all that. and I said, like, well, so how many people are doing a film course and how many people are doing a writing course and graduating from all these prestigious unis? It's going to be thousands, isn't it, every year? Yep. So why would you get a job that there's like five going every 10 year or whatever to get in this place? Why would you get the job? And I think that's what it comes down to. It's like, what is it, what separates you? What, and then it's like, let me show you what I can do.
Well,
maybe maybe you're great at pitching, but I mean, that's my attitude, that you make something and then show them, like, 100%. Here's what I'm about.
Yep. In 2013, actually, I was on the workshop called Jump Cut, and I was locations, and I think I was third AD. And one of the mentors on that worked at River City and invited me to shadow them on River City. So I'd have been like shadowing AD and then maybe getting a runner job at it. And I remember going to training at Dumbarton one morning, and I got after it at Rang Stope. And I just took it as a sign, like, I wasn't meant to do this. But then a year later, drop him off, Michael happened, and that might not have happened if I'd got after the right stop.
You'd be too tired to be going home.
Exactly,
and
that's it. I wouldn't have wrote it. I wouldn't have came up with it. So it's like, I definitely think the directing and writing is, I think it's the only one of the main jobs where you learn by doing. I do think being on sets can be really good for just like learning etiquette and seeing how everybody's working and all that. But it's like, you need to be making stuff. You really do, man.
These people have got no time, but like, even.
Oh, definitely, I know, 100%.
To even like take you under, because they don't, you know what it's a set's like as well?
Definitely, yep.
3-man crew or 100-man crew, like, it's, there's money been burned, as they say, do you mean? Like, so nobody got time to say, so they say like family and that, with the best intentions, and say like, you know, maybe get a job as an extra and all that, and you, because you never know what could happen. And it's like, we've spoken about that, it's like, you do never know, but it's very unlikely, because these people are so busy and they're not looking to take MD under their wing. And that's one of the big problems, I think, is it just costs so much money. And one of the ways you can learn is by being on set, and nobody will respect you unless you have done it yourself, I think. So it's like, you just need to do it at any level.
Aye, that's how that's the very first thing I done. When I was doing my other degree before film, I was like, right, I'll see what it's like on sets before I like pull the trigger to drop this degree and go do film. But being an extra, it's so funny, man. Just like it's either the most sound people you've met, or the other half of the extras are just people that are like, oh, Brad Pitt was an extra. Like, I'm gonna be the next Brad Pitt types. And yeah. You're just like,
no, I mean, you look like a frog.
But the reality is that everyone else in the set, you are absolute like scum on the bottom of their shoe, man.
It's cattle, so man.
No, definitely.
But I knew then, I was like, right, I've seen how a set works. Like, I'm not doing this. Like, it was a good laugh playing cards for 6 hours and stuff like that. Like in the barras for some show, but. That's it. You do need to just go out and make stuff. Like,
100%.
I think a lot of that's not me shitting on those programs, though. Stuff like The Network and what was the other one? Jump Cut.
Oh, no, look, man,
like, they're invaluable.
Aye,
man.
Definitely.
Like, the
Jump Cut, it did change my life. No, I mean, but it's like, as I said, it's like after that, I realized, like, oh, no, I need to just go out and make stuff, or else it's all just going to stop. You know what I mean? So it's like, you do just need to make stuff. Find your tribe, man. Get people around you who are up for it, and just. You make stuff, just go for it.
Yeah. Is there something in particular that motivates that like to make stuff? Because it's really hard to get that started. Like, what motivates that for you guys?
If you want to be a director, then I mean, that's it. Just like, I'll do anything to get in. That's my thing. Like, how do I do this like full time? How do I not like? How do you get paid to do this basically? And how do you even just get in the door and become a director? That's me, really.
100%. That's it, man. Just loving film and television. I mean, it's like you want to be a part of it, and look, if there's nothing else you want to do, it's like you'll die trying. You know what I mean? That's like, you just want to keep at it, man.
Definitely.
I kind of wanted to go that route before that Kieran had went, but after I'd heard Kieran's story from a while back, the whole like the car incident thing, like that's the thing that for me, I was just like, right, I'm just going to lean full time into running like a media company, just doing video stuff, so that it's like I'm actually behind the camera. Like, I'm no directing, you know, like fiction stuff and my own scripts necessarily, but it's at least something where it's like
time on camera.
I'm getting experience and stuff.
But you've
like that
also a fantastic short film, man. You made a
very
beautiful short film.
Aye, 2018,
Thursday, son.
Cheers, man. But I've told myself like this year I'm making my next thing. Like, I'm just gonna go do it, because it's like we've just been saying, like, you need to just go do it. You need to go make stuff. So even just get favors for people, see if MD will help. So just things like that. But we've got yous on because yous are in the film festival, obviously, next week. So Paul, just starting with you, like, tell us what Angry Young Men's about. Just kind of a wee quick summary.
A surreal coming of age tale. What's it about plot wise? Sort of like a fight for territory, I would say. I'm really bad at describing the plot. What I would say is, like, there's great exciting moments, there's bits of, there's good humour, a soundtrack I'm really proud of. What else do you say about it? I'd say it's an exciting piece of cinema. That's what I would say. That'd be enough to get me to come, so that's what I'm going to say.
I've heard a few of the interviews you've been doing where it's people always ask, oh, what were the inspirations and stuff? But for me, when I was kind of getting involved in that and just watching the cuts and stuff, it's like, it was always the Warriors for me that kind of evoked. Like, that was a big one that I've no heard being that's, said, really.
As soon as you see a gang and everything, it's like, but I suppose it's slightly different, like, because that's based on the Odyssey, isn't it? It's like, trying to get home and all that, and how you get home. And but I suppose you put, I just think, when I think about it, it's like, tone and that and emotion, I don't know, I was thinking of different things. People, the festival, when they wrote up about it, they said the Wild Bunch and John Carpenter, which I can get, and I'm fine with that, and it's up to everybody how they interpret it, but you've got your own ideas. But see, at the end of the day, whatever was my inspiration, nothing I can say about it. Do you mean it's like, people take it how they take it, so I'm interested to see what people take from it, because maybe it'll reveal more about me than I'd planned, so who knows.
No, so it's quite a colourful piece, obviously, all the costumes and stuff like that, but it's got a good heart to it as well, man. I think that's a really big part of it. It's not really been, like, it'll be good for people to be in the cinema to experience, obviously. It's kind of hard. I know what you mean, but it's kind of hard to describe that almost. But what about your one, Skint, then? So tell us a bit about the
kind of... Well, I feel like a kind of fraud, man, because it's a BBC4 series. It's not really a film. But I directed 2 episodes, so half an hour I can vouch for. I've not seen that, good enough. So I wrote and directed the episode that Peter Mullins in, and then I directed another episode by a brilliant writer called Byron Vincent. I think the script was better than mine. It's one of the most beautiful scripts I've ever read. And that one starred Michael Soccer for This Is England, who is just an absolute legend as
great
well.
Actor, man.
A really beautiful human being, man. Like, can't recommend him highly enough. Like, really, really cool guy. So it's a series of monologues, and, you know, like, I'd seen BBC monologues before, and I'm not saying anything bad about them, but they can be quite still and kind of like theatre. So my whole thing was like, how do I do these and make it like short films, or like, you know, kind of get a wee bit of a cinematic feel? So I tried to do that, where I'm kind of just write it as short, didn't make them like I was making a short film basically, and get that kind of sense of a kind of sense of arc, really, the kind of sense of story. And hopefully it worked. So 2 episodes of mine. The one's called Taking a Bog Hill Street, and the other one's called Jambo. No grasses, no nonsense. So
how did you feel? Because I'm right in saying that one's your writer director. Is that no? You
one of them, your
director.
Yep.
How did you feel directing just something that's not your material? Was it quite freeing? Were you kind of like, I'm quite glad to just be focusing on the visual, or did you?
I was actually terrifying. I don't want to give too much away, but it's quite a heavy subject matter, and I could tell that it came from a very personal place for the writer. And the writer's an amazing guy, man. I've got plans to collaborate with him and a lot more stuff in the future. Like, he's such a cool character. Based in London, I lived a roller coaster of a life, and just an amazing artist and writer. I felt it was intense pressure. Like, I better get this right. Like, I want to do this justice. And last year was the first time I directed 2 things that I didn't write. It was Infectious Nihilism and his episode with Skint. And I do really enjoy it, man. I must admit, like, I do love it. I do, like, you know, I mean, I love the collaboration, and I just feel like it's me being finally taking a bit more serious as a director, you know what I mean, rather than having to keep writing my own material. It was great, man. I really did enjoy it, but it is an intense pressure to be like, because I know how it feels. I've had other people direct my work, and it's like, it can go one of 2 ways, you know what I mean, where it's like, you either end up gutted or really happy. So
was he on set? No,
he did. Up on set, man. I think he came up on his own dime, man, and like, and I'll be honest, he was so like, he was just such a beautiful human being. He just sat in the monitor, didn't even, like, at times when I was asking him, he just kind of didn't, just wanted to leave me, let me do my thing. And
good for him, man.
I know, absolute gentleman, man. And he's such an amazing writer. Like, genuinely is one of the most beautiful scripts I've ever read. Like, he's such a good writer and a really, really cool cat. I check him out, Mighty Buzzled on Instagram, man. Byron Vincent, really, really cool guy.
What one I would love to see your written directed feature, but one thing I'd love to see is you, Graham Armstrong, doing a feature, because I want to see that Infectious Nihilism. That's playing at the short film.
I keep forgetting to plug that, man. Infectious Nihilism playing March 27th at Glasgow Short Film Festival. And Graham's amazing, man. I love Graham a lot. Like,
how did that partnership come about?
Do you know, man, it's an interesting one. So I was actually in the running to adapt a TV show into a book, and
no, I don't want to speak out of turn. It should have been you.
Thank you for saying that. I appreciate that, man. I don't disagree. No, I'm kidding. I actually know that. I know the writer that got to get. I met him. He was really nice to me. He won't remember me, but he was really lovely to me at a BAFTA thing. He's actually a nice guy to get got a gig. And then, but I think Graham was game for me to do it. So he always kept me in mind. And when this book festival thing came along, we were making short films that he put my name forward for it, which was legendary of him. And then, we just collaborated too well. In a weird way, man, it's like, we should be like best pals. We're like very similar. Like, we should be seeing each other all the time, but it's almost like we're just like too similar. It's really odd.
Same guy.
Yeah, same bells. But he's an absolute genius. And his next book's going to be, I don't think Scotland's even ready for his next book, man.
Braveheart.
I think it's going to be an absolute masterpiece. If anybody's expecting, like, it's not going to be like a repeat of Young Team. It's going to be like a really unique masterpiece, and I'm excited for him to drop it on his, man. It's going to be a bomb.
He read the audiobook, was dynamite, man. Like, he does like all the singing and all the chants, and it just adds so much to it. But that's what I mean, like, it should have been you, because it's so clear that, I mean, I don't know how the set was, but it just seemed like you were just in such good unison with each other, like the way the camera worked, because it's not very heavy dialogue, I would say. There's so many just visual pieces. But even the detail, like the scarves on the fence and like the wee glances, and who's the youngster that's been in your show?
That's Kyle Gordon, man. He's an absolute brilliant actor. Anybody needs a young actor in from Glasgow, man, cast Kyle Gordon. He was in Boys Night, Spiral, and Fictional Island. Amazing actor.
He was great in that. And it's just having that, the scenes in the house, and like when the way the camera moves, and the wee bokeh, the light, and I thought, fuck, man, this needs to be like a feat. I just really do think that was such a good partnership. But again, I don't know how it worked in terms of the set, but it was so good.
Oh, no, man, it was great, man. It was great. And look, man, me and Graham, we were under a lot of pressure, man. Like, it was like, it was an intense shoot. Like they were making like 7 of those short films or something. So it was like, you know, you were just one of many. So it was like, it was kind of on me and Graham's shoulders to like really, like, let's try and make this as good as we can. And
what was your schedule? How long were you shooting for?
We had 2 days on it, so like, which is, it's decent, man, but it was a lot to get in 2 days. And I'm really proud of it. I love it a lot, man. I think it's one of the most visually beautiful things I've been involved with. And Graham's just an amazing writer. Like, he just got such a real talent, and just like a big heart. Like, he just really cares about, like, you know, it's like he just cares about, you know, young Scottish people, and like, no repeating, you know, the cycles that we've all been through. And so he's a good guy, man. And I know, man, we've got plans to do other stuff with each other, man. But it's you know, he's gonna skyrocket to the moon and forget about me soon anyway, so I'm just gonna let him do this, man.
who's Lost Boy Found, what's his, Tom, is it?
Tosh, the bull Tosh.
He's fucking, man.
I know. He made the trailer. Did you see him in the trailer?
No,
he's in the Glasgow Short Film Festival trailer. I dancing. Right. I had to go to him. Never been fixing either, man.
See, he is a writer performer, because he did that one man show, like one man show, but it was like a heavy monologue. That was unreal, man.
I watched that whole thing when you said it, man. It's
100%.
I mean, that's someone else. You're like, fuck, what does he? What's someone I need to do? Like, he's just like so good.
We tried to get Douglas King tried to get a documentary on him made with the Scottish Documentary Institute. They ended up knocking it back, man. And I just felt like his story's undeniable. You know what I mean? He's such a powerful character and such a powerful voice. And I think he's going to succeed regardless. Like, he'll make it, man. But it's just a matter of keeping at it. I think that's the main thing. Like, I know this thing, no matter what age you are, man, in Scotland, like, it's going to be hard. It's something harder, I think, if you're older. You know what I mean? Like, you need to really just keep going, man, and just get your name out there. And I know, as his mentors, like, what more does he need to do? He did 2 award-winning Fringe shows, which are stunning. He's an amazing actor.
He's really funny as well. It seems spiral. He's got a wee line. But just even like his wee bit when he's with the gear, when he's like, it's just wee lines just here and there. And he's just like, he's got a great timing. And then Infectious Nihilism, he's there. And he's just, and when selling the guns in Spiral as well. There's just so many wee moments. And you're just like, he's incredible, man. It's like people like that, like, you don't get like great character actors. Like, when I think of people, it's like, him, Steve McCall.
Yep.
Who's like, see, something that makes you might think that sounds stupid, right? But I think a great Scottish character, Rory McCann.
The big one, the
Hound and all.
Aye, amazing.
Is it what's his name? O'Hara.
David O'Hara.
David O'Hara.
I'd love to work with him, man.
Mate, that's my dream. I've got a son I'm working on now. He's got three uncles, and I wanted to be Stephen McCall, O'Hara, and McCann. Imagine that pairing.
Oh,
like,
amazing. I know.
On it. Definitely. I'm going to manifest it right now.
I actually met with Stephen McCall to play the dad in Boys Night, man. And it was purely down to, like, look, everybody knows he'd have smashed it. Like, he's an amazing actor. But Cameron Jack just really reminded me of my dad. I love Cameron. My Cameron's amazing as well. Cameron's like a brilliant actor.
He's one of the best on screen drunks I think I've ever seen, man.
Yes.
Genuinely.
Nice, Cameron, man. Oh, that's great. He's such a lovely guy too. He's so cool, man. I watched his, he's popped up in that Guy Ritchie's new film. He's in Wrath of Man. He's
good for him, man.
Got an amazing montage where he's like taking people out. It's really cool.
He's been a kind of background heavy in quite a lot of stuff. He was in the Dark Knight Rises or something. Bane
breaks his neck. That's pretty cool, man.
Tosh is after seeing that stage show thing, I think you sent me, it was like on Vimeo or something a few years ago. I'm like, that's a guy I want to work with, man.
He's got plans to write a book and stuff, so I hope he gets it going, man. Cast Tosh, man. Like, with something like that, it's like, not only do you get a wealth of acting talent, you get an authenticity you just can't get, you know what I mean, anywhere else. Like, he's a real deal, you know what I mean? Like, he'll bring a real authenticity that you won't get anywhere else.
That's the thing in Scotland, like, to cast an actor, it's like, not to, there's some people are best for playing certain roles, but if you get someone who's straight out theatre school and you get them to be part of that, like, that sort of life, it's like, they don't know what are they using as examples? Do you mean like Iago? Do you mean, or like the or Shylock? I mean, like, they're going to use like theatrical references. They're not going to use like people that they know, or like, and then you get someone who could walk into a set who can act, but then also knows that world and can draw upon people they've seen. And it's the same with writing, I think, as well. Like, there's just something different. There's like a vein through it that just you can't learn about. And it's like,
you can't fake it. No, definitely. I'll be honest. I won't name any names. Like, I've made stuff in the past, and I've just, like, you know, I've miscast people at times, like I said, like in Melodies, and you know, it does show, like, you do need sometimes, you do need people to have lived a bit of life to bring an authenticity to a role, and it's just something that you just can't fake it.
But it's a hard balance, because getting someone who's from there, then who also isn't crippled with being so self-conscious,
definitely.
Because to be able to be yourself or be real, I mean, you all know, you've all done stuff in front of the camera. It's terrifying.
Like, 100%.
You have such a respect for actors when they do that.
When I did the music video, I acted in.
That was brilliant, man. You were so good in that.
I tried to get Tosh to. That was for Tosh, and then Tosh backed it. He chicked us. Aye, man. And I just went full Alfred Molina and Boogie Nights. A la Poso.
You're in the next thing, mate. I'm making.
Oh, get me in there, man.
Suited just for you.
I acted in a short film that's playing at the festival as well. Sean Hughes's Life of Riley. Right. But I was a small part in that, so I look out for me, man.
Nah, there's definitely something to say about that, though, in terms of the acting. Like, I feel like if I'm casting, not that I've got much experience, obviously, it's just that one sort of student one, but. My experience is just that the people that don't actually train in acting seem to be better, from my experience anyway. It's just like the people that can be a bit more authentic. Does they feel like they're...
There's bad habits.
It's the kind of like Glasgow uni accent almost about things. Yeah. Like they can't pull it off. Like, I know acting's acting. You don't need to literally be the person you're playing, but it's just something about getting real people who don't have experience to jump into things. They're just...
Yeah,
it's just better, I think.
100%. I think one of my best formulas, though, that I've always swore by is, like, getting a trained actor, putting them together with a non-actor, and they bring the best to each other. Like, a trained actor will raise a non-actor up, and a non-actor will bring a trained actor down to reality. And I think you can get a really beautiful combination when you do it like that.
That's a great idea. They're both bad habits. Like,
100%.
You're mumbling, but then you're hamming it. It's almost like
they balance each other out, man. I think it works really well. I really do, man. I think it's
Harry will know as well. Like, our pal Matthew.
He's not
a trained actor or anything. He's like an engineer down south in a like shipyard or something. But he's one of the best. He could have been Jim Carrey, man. He could have been a big Scottish comedian.
Has he been in anything that you've done?
He's done a few wee skits with us.
Oh, is he?
Gary did that. The Benji Bear one?
That's the one. Was he in the costume?
Nice, I remember that.
There's something about his brand of humor, man. He's just so dry. It's like, I was about to say kind of Little Wimmy, but it's not. It's just, it's kind of comparable to him in the sense where it's just like they're no like MD Elves, the way they're funny. Do you know what I mean? Like, but that's what I mean, though. It's just like people like that are sometimes just like the sort of hidden gems, man. But see, on Angry Young Men, like, you obviously had a massive cast on that. There, like, people, there was a lot of people where it was just like me kind of in the background, but like the you know, the classic sort of torn up. Why am I the poncho? Aye. But did you get a lot of people that were kind of going to acting school? Was that a lot? That was a lot of your pals as well, wasn't it? So
it was, but it's interesting, like, what Price is saying. Like, there is something about, there's a certain quality sometimes. Like, there's one, I remember like three, maybe like a handful of people were all actors, but Owen, who's like what the kind of lead mask character, he brings the best of both worlds, because he's like a just a real guy, but he's done so much stage work, so he's got this great voice control. And which is something that I think that non-actors maybe don't get.
Like, 100%,
yeah. That way where you can pitch and where it'll be intonations where you can't be monotonous, like, and it's not, they just, there's a great control you get, but then he's able to put that through his own personality, because he's not like a Lovage. I mean, even though he can go on stage and he can play any role. So Owen was great. There was also like Stephen Arthur, he's trained as well, but he's also just like a normal guy. Like, he's just like a, you could speak to him about anything. But then there's also people who are maybe quite theatrical, but when you put them in certain roles and you pair them with someone, they bring a sort of kind of a different element to it. Can maybe talk more about it after the film and stuff, but I do think that there is a good mix, and there is a lot to be said, because learning lines, doing retakes, do you mean, like, there's all these things that, like, acting, like, you can't get around certain things that, like, you do need a bit of training for. So I would say that you do need, even if you are someone who's legit, you do need to put your hours in as well.
Definitely, 100%, aye, 100%.
Well, so Alex is your lead man. He was doing the more kind of recent BBC interview, if that's coming out the night maybe, but that's be recording. But
That'll be the week of the festival, I think they're going to put that out. But that's he's an artist, he's trained and he's doing excellent. That. But he's not like, you mean, you would meet him and say, you could talk to these people, do you mean you're not going to speak to him? And then, because a lot of people, like, people say, like, footballers and all that, it's like, oh, they're terrible on the mic after. That's not their job. So it's almost like an actor. They don't have to be sitting behind the set and being, like, the life and soul. It's like, if they can come on and turn it on and then afterwards, they're a total bastard. Like, I don't have any real problem with that. Do you mean, we're not looking here to become pals. I'd like to be pals with everybody you work with, but at the same time, if they are perfect for the role, there's a lot of them that were. They were just a great balance, and everyone was sound on the film, so no complaints.
That's it. So what's kind of next for you? You were talking, kind of touching on that earlier when we were talking about Graham, what's the kind of next in the pipeline for you then?
I've got a thing that's happening up in Dundee pretty soon, which is quite exciting, man. I don't know how much I can say about it, but it's a bit bigger than what I usually do, so it's quite exciting. So hopefully that'll be out for next year. Hopefully, maybe, possibly playing the festival next year. I don't know if it would depend how it goes. Low budget, but we can make it work. But look, man, I just want to make a bunch of shorts, man. Like, I want to work with Graham again. I'd love to do something with Graham again. Got a thing I want to do with Johnny Watson that I'm really excited about. With Johnny Watson and Kyle Gordon, actually, for Infection Nihilism, I've got a thing I want to team NATO up for. And I've got a crazy thing I want to do with the bold Brian McCardy again, man, because I just love working with him. I just love the way he says my words. I just want to keep making stuff, man. So if anybody's, look, any angel investors out there, anybody just got a bunch of money that just wants to fund me and Paul's and Gary's films, man, please just give us some dough. And I just throw some dough at us, man. Clean it, gangsters, whatever it is, man. Just give some dirty money. We'll put it to good use.
Jonathan Watson's a real film buff, isn't he?
Oh man, he's an absolute.
I didn't realise.
100%, like, a pure cinephile. And I'm really excited about what we've lined up, man. We've been working on something for a while now. And
you did the trailer for the festival last year.
That's right. Aye, man. I know. You know, he's amazing, man. Like, he is. He's like just such a absolute professional. And a total film genius, like, absolute, like, aficionado, man, and
local hero.
He's
to the roots, man.
100%, no, definitely. I know that's, you forget, like, just how long he's been around, and worked with Tom Sizemore in that Scottish football film. What one was that again?
Did he?
Aye, what was the one? Was the one McCoysters in? It was after that. I can't remember.
What do you think of Heat then? Just, I need to say this, address this while Harry's
hell,
on.
Man.
Masterpiece.
What's Harry? Is Harry not a fan of Heat?
Harry's got a problem with Michael Mann in general.
What?
Fuck, you're behind a screen.
I know, you're lucky, man. I'd plug you on site, man. You're getting done, bro. That's what you order. You get done? What's the problem with Michael Mann?
That's the wrong man to say.
I know, Harry. Yeah. I'll leave that to him. Go for it, Harry.
I feel like Michael Mann, he's one of the directors who has talent, but he just wants to put everything in his films. So he doesn't edit.
Shut up,
I feel like a lot of the scenes, like, I think you could cut that. That is way too long.
One heat. I'm curious to hear what would you cut? I think that's one of the few films that justifies its length.
It's perfect. Yeah.
There are scenes in that that are like
not the shower scene between, with De
Niro. No, you know the scene where they're in the diner and they're just chatting. Like,
oh my god, are you kidding me?
That's not funny, man. Don't you play the games with us? Yeah, man.
Man. Claro as well, man.
Tom Cruise, man, and Claro.
We need to see Tom Manhunter. Cruise, literally,
Manhunter is one of my favorite films of all time. Like, Manhunter might be my favorite film of all time.
It's got some faff in it as well, actually.
I'm gonna slap you. I swear to God, boys. I swear to God, I'm gonna hurt you, man.
You're coming up for the film festival, man.
Do you like Silence of the Lambs?
Oh, I do like Silence of the Lambs. I do.
I'm a massive Jonathan Demme fan. Man, my favorite film is Something Wild. I love Jonathan Demme, man. But look. And Anthony Hopkins is a great actor. Amazing actor, fine, right? But look, if I'm in a room with Brian Cox and fucking Anthony Hopkins, I'm scared of Brian Cox. I'm not scared of Anthony Hopkins. Anthony Hopkins looks like a uni lecturer, man. I'll slap Anthony Hopkins if he tries to eat me. If Brian Cox tries to eat me, he's going to hold me down and eat me. Right? And I'm telling you, I can't get a problem, Michael, man. What, did he shoot his films too beautifully? Did he sound too amazing? How dare you, man? This podcast is done. This is cancelled.
The trailer for this podcast, this has to be clipped, man.
I'm disgusted. How many I came with it?
He is a masterpiece. I genuinely think, and then even look at what Nolan did with the opening of Dark Knight. Yeah. That's Heat, and he said it 100%. Himself. He's obviously said it's an homage or whatever, but what he did, the way he shot LA, I've never seen it done like that. There's LA crime films, To Live and Die in LA.
Yep.
What's the one Russell Crowe, is that To Live and Die in LA?
No, LA Confidential.
LA Confidential. There's been ways it's been shot, but it's got this sort of like sunburnt look. Yep. And he has this like blue colour palette in LA.
Aye, definitely, man, 100%.
It's like midnight kind of, everything filmed, it feels like it's filmed at midnight, that kind of thing. Feels like there's nobody
around.
Don't
try and save yourself now, Harry. Don't you dare.
But even
appreciate bits about Heat, but an overall, like, I can appreciate that scene in the diner. I think that's fantastic, that the acting between them two.
The shootout scene.
I appreciate the scene at the end, and the heist as well. The heist
is the only movie
holding hands at the end.
Yes,
that's Moby's playing, man.
Moby, God moving over the face of waters, Harry. That doesn't make you feel something. I'm gonna say something right now. Like, that's the only movie that genuinely makes me like almost tear up every time. What does it say? Told you I wasn't going back. It's like, what? Man, I get goosebumps right now. I'm tingling, Harry.
I'm saying is that they could cut some of the faff. That's all I'm saying.
What faff, bro?
I don't see it.
Yeah.
See where you gain in efficiency? Sometimes you lose in the heart rate, man. I think if you make it tight as fuck, then you get this momentum. But then also what you lose is the bond that they've got. Because it takes so long, it's almost like, because he meets someone. So maybe if you could say, let's say you cut half an hour from Heat. You start off, De Niro's already with that character. He's not. He doesn't meet her in the diner. They're all together. Mm. Vincent's with his missus. They're all together. And say you start at the moment where they're on the roof and they're watching them at dinner. An hour or half an hour into the film.
Yeah.
But then you get the scene where it's like, these guys are good. And it's like, they've sent them to the docks.
Yeah.
And they're all, De Niro's watching them, chasing them.
Yep.
The scene in the lorry, when the guy bumps the lorry and then they throw the job off. Now you could say, plot wise, does that need to happen? You could just have it being cops and robbers. The Waingrove scene.
Yeah.
I mean, that whole thread, fucking John Voight's whole thread.
John Voight playing Eddie Bunker is like one of the best things ever. And also, and I'm thinking like because I'm not, you've got me down myself. I'm like, would I cut the Natalie Portman bit? And I'm like, no, wouldn't he? Because that shows like Pacino was like so caught up in his work. He's like, no, therefore the people that it should be like, and oh man,
the mirror images each other, and I think you need all that. It's phenomenal.
It's a masterpiece. It's a,
I know what you said that I love the scene where Pacino comes onto the after the truck heist, and he's just like just stating exactly what's happening. That just takes control of the scene. I do like that scene.
I got two dead bodies of a Venice boardwalk, Justine. I'm sorry if a goddamn chicken got cold.
Knowing you, being an animal that hates Michael Mann, you would have cut the scene where he goes, she's got a great ass.
No, that would be just, that would be that on repeat for about 40 minutes, and then I cut most of the other stuff.
I hope you bought the t-shirt, mate.
I've got the Blu-ray. I've got the extended edition Blu-ray that I've seen like three times now, and I've never got behind it. I'm going to try it again on your guys' recommendation.
But I'm sorry I threw you under the bus, Harry, but you know, I can't tolerate Michael Mann slander.
I can't even think, that moment, De Niro's like, he's away, he's free, and he just can't let Wayne Grove live, man. It's that U-turn. It's like, oh.
He is one of the biggest bastards in a movie.
Oh, 100%. They couldn't have made him more evil, man. Like, there's no way to make him more evil.
Every box, man.
That's it. 100%. Like, and it's so, and it works. It just works. It's so good. And by the way, anybody ever seen LA Takedown?
The original one.
It was kind of like almost a Miami Vice-ish, where it's kind of like a TV movie. But at the end of that, instead of going into the hotel room and shooting Wayne Grove, I think Wayne Grove kills Neil McCauley, and then Pacino shows up. Pacino's character, Vincent Hanna, shows up and karate kicks Wayne Grove off a balcony. And that's right. I don't care what you say. Even LA Takedown's a masterpiece, and that's got some madness in it.
And what about Miami Vice then? What about that?
Oh, don't you start me, man. Start, I swear to God. That's actually a big part of Skin.
That's
this is blasphemous at this point. And I'll even defend the film. The film's a masterpiece.
Harry, please recover this relationship. Yes, I'll never speak to Bryce again.
No, this is done, man.
Miami Vice, the TV show. Love it, man. Love the energy of that show, but I'm not a fan of the film, mate.
I'm telling you, man, that film is a masterpiece, and that film will age good with time. Like, that is a movie where the bad guy gets away. Like, nobody makes those movies, man. It's a master. I don't care what anybody says. Like, that movie's going to age really well. People are going to look back on that and be like, oh, it's going to be a Michael Mann retrospective. They're going to be like, oh, what a genius.
Tell you what, Harry, see, since we're bringing this back, we'll do LA Takedown as soon as we can. Do you have a copy of that, James?
I got it on DVD. Let's do it, guys.
Like, he's a copy, mate. So, no, speaking of LA Takedown, actually, that's one of the rare examples of something where a filmmaker's got to remake their own film.
Hitchcock. Mm.
I was going to ask whatever examples of that.
Who remade their own film or remade it like in another version? Mm. Officially, I mean, you could argue some like that Renoir thing, you make one film and then you break it apart and remake it every other time, like you only make one film, but I mean, who did remake their own? The only thing that I can think of remakes, Scarface, Hawks and De Palma.
Mm. The Departed.
Infernal Affairs.
Which is great by itself, actually. Give that a watch if you haven't watched that. It's great.
Yeah, Infernal Affairs.
But I think that's one of the few times where I will say like an American movie like improved upon the original.
Well, the one thing that's interesting, I've only seen a comparison, and it said, see, that one of the best scenes is when he phones a dead man's phone, but he's like in a busy environment, but in The Departed it's dead silence, and the two of them just, I mean, that is an
improvement. Yeah, isn't it? 100%. They made it much more interesting. I don't know if that's the new William Moynihan, the writer, or Scorsese, but they made a better film of it, and also David O'Hara in that. Oh. I've got a theory, by the way, that the bit in The Departed where Jack Nicholson shouts at David O'Hara,
"Don't let
this ain't reality TV." I'm convinced that David O'Hara is corpsing, and that's Jack Nicholson shouting at the actor.
Oh, really?
I just got a feeling, man.
We'll use it.
If you rewatch it, I really do think that's what's happening in that scene. I could be wrong, but I feel like that's a possibility, man.
That's so good.
Jack Nicholson, he's one of those guys, you just put him on camera, he does his own thing. That man is just, he's just loose cannon. That
he's
fella.
One of the greatest. He's one of the greatest of all time, man.
That's what I want to be. I'm going to be the Jack Nicholson of the Scottish film scene. I've decided.
Go for it.
Apparently, because he's directed himself. He directed like a sequel to Chinatown and all that. And I think he wanted to be a director, and he's written a lot. And apparently, Matt Damon says for The Departed, when he met him for the first time, it's him and Jack Nicholson in a room. And Jack Nicholson got up to make a coffee and he goes, "You know, I wouldn't be such a great fucking actor if I wasn't such a great fucking writer," and something like that. And you can totally believe that.
100%.
Like, he knows, even the way he improvises and the way he chooses his fucking, like, his dialogue and the way he moves. Because you can say, people say he's like a persona or he's like a star, but like, Last Detail, Chinatown.
Last Detail is one of my favorite. Amazing, man.
Five Easy Pieces.
He's stunning.
Joker. Yep. I mean, he's a fucking method actor. Like, he's so good.
Oh,
he's
definitely,
phenomenal.
Man. The Crossing Guard. The Borders, one of my favourites, man, with him and Keitel. That's a masterpiece.
What's it called? The Borders?
The Border, right. Oh, great movie, man. Like, you'll love it. You'll love The Border, man. Looks so good.
The Shining as well, man. That's
obviously, aye, man. Of course, 100%. Aye. I know, man. He's great. He is. He's a master.
Aye. So
speaking of absolute bastard characters, actually, him in A Few Good Men.
I don't know, mate.
So good.
Yeah. I mean, he just cuts his hair and then he changes his whole nature and he goes for the sinister and he can do humour and he can do everything that he can, but he just changes slightly. He's the man.
Yes, man. Yeah.
But no, I was just wondering about the LA Takedown thing, because it's a kind of unique example of that where somebody's got to go back and remake their own thing. But it's something I've spoke to all 3 years about till I'm blue in the face, like my own short. It's like, oh, you, like, I hate it. Like, oh, it's like, oh, I'd have done this and that differently. Yeah. But it's like kind of learning that that's part of the experience of making something. It's like, not that you're meant to hate everything you do, but like just the... it's good if you know, like, oh, I could do that differently. Like,
my girlfriend's off camera, man, she'll vouch for this, but like, I don't hate, but I've got a problem with every film I've made. Like, even Boys Night Spiral, like, I see a bunch of stuff that I should have did differently, scenes I should have cut, like, things that alternate takes that I didn't put in that I wish I did. Like, that stuff keeps me up at night. But it's like, you know, you never finish a film that I'm going to take it away for you at some point. You need to just let it go. But, I don't think I'm completely satisfied with anything I've made yet. I'm excited for that day to come. Although the day that comes, that's probably the day I make something terrible. You know what I mean? I'll be like, this is awful, but I like it.
Shouldn't do. I think the important thing is getting it finished. Like, you hate everything you ever do, or you just never finish it, and then that's terrible as well. And you're sort of turning to Zanetka, New York, man. You're just living in this massive palace, and you're just like, okay, now we're going to do it here, and you're 100 years old, and you're trying to make this masterpiece. It's like, you need to give it away at one point, man.
You do, man, 100%.
You've got to kind of separate it for you at some point. That's it, but I wouldn't, as much as I say I hate it, I don't hate it, but like, I wouldn't want to go back and try redo any of it. I always just kind of want to go on to the next thing, do you know what I mean? I think that's kind of important as well, like just finding your next kind of project or whatever. But
I think reusing elements, I think if you like,
I am the same,
do you know what I mean? Like,
you like certain
dynamics, you like a friendship, or you like a plot line. I mean, I think there's probably so many examples of that. I mean, argue like, Scorsese's crime films, probably, do you know what I mean? But you never say what they are remakes of each other. They're totally different, even though there's, I mean, nuances. Like, look at the power dynamic Casino compared to Goodfellas.
Yeah.
Even though Joe Pesci is like this terrifying guy, he's like against De Niro in Casino, and then also Billy Batts gets his revenge. And like, do you mean, there's so many wee things that kind of come full circle. And I think, you can use certain elements, but I mean, I don't know. And I know the only one I can think of is Hitchcock is like an out and out remake of yourself. But I think you need to have like a 50-year career. Do you mean, I think I you do to do that?
Yeah,
why would you want to?
Would you want to remake something that you've done?
I think if you make short films, you're in a unique position where you probably can, like, you can make a feature or a short. I mean, but I don't know if that's the same thing.
That's different.
But back to LA Takedown, quick fun fact, trivia fact. The only actor that's in LA Takedown and Heat is, you know, the guy with Pacino's like, you don't get to watch my fucking television. He's Wayne Grove.
Is he?
He's Wayne Grove in LA Takedown.
The one that's cheating with his
man. Yeah.
Is that not... what's his name? Hank?
His stepdad and no. That's just cheating with Val Kilmer's wife.
Hank
Azaria. He's his stepdad in Terminator 2.
Mm. Oh,
the
is
guy
he?
Guy when he gets the
thing
put through his face. The melting Terminator kills him.
What an arse. Amazing film, man.
Sorry, fun facts with prices. I just put it off track.
Have you got any fun facts?
You got any noise in the mail, Hardy? What's happening?
I've got a fun fact, but it's nothing about a film, so I'm just going to leave it alone.
Here's the one I'd like to know, right? So I think about Terminator 2. In Terminator 2, when Paul Thomas Anderson went to film school, it was his first day or something, one of the lecturers went, if you're here to make Terminator 2, you can just leave now or something. Did you have any of that in your course? Was there any sort of snobbery from lecturers in terms of types of films or like what you should be into? Because that's... we're talking about people who go to like theatre groups or people that go to... they all kind of maybe pick up each other's bad habits. I'm convinced that no matter what you do, you might be a rebel in your own right, but if you're in a classroom, you're trying to get a grade, you're trying to please the lecturer, so in some way you're going to pick up a bad habit. Was there anything like that you thought, I need to conform to this style of like, I need to do art house, or I need to do something that's like humour? Did you feel that at all?
Oh, absolutely. It's the most subjective course possible. Like, it's exactly what you've just said. It's, you're catering to the person who's running the class pretty much. So if they're a pure MCU superhero person, then it's... that's what all the chat in class is about. So, you know, or if they're a Michael Mann fan, I wish you should have been a lecturer, mate.
Give me a job, one of your unis out there. Doug King's Sean Hughes as well.
That's the best case scenario. Somebody that's been through the trenches and it could actually give you proper advice, because they know they're like balanced guys. They could say it's 100%. Maybe not my cup of tea, but I can admire what you've done here. But
I can also vouch that they both have impeccable taste in films. Like they've got good taste, man. So, and that's to me the most important thing with anybody in life. Like, good taste.
100%.
Oh, I just thought one that's been remade by his own director. Funny Games. Michael Haneke.
Oh, that's a good point. Yeah, man, that's true. I remade that with Michael Pitt, didn't he? That's right. I know. But it's weird. It's kind of shot for shot, and it's interesting. It's
exactly shot for shot.
Not someone who's remade their own film, but this is the strangest case I've ever heard. Gus Van Sant remakes Psycho shot for shot, and his justification was, "I did it so no one else would have to."
What?
With Vince Vaughn as
he had done one moment.
What about
the end?
No, there's a moment where Vince Vaughn's watching what's her name? Oh, it's gonna annoy me, man. I forgot her name. She's Donnie Brasco's wife.
Oh yeah, I know her name.
I forgot her name. Anyway, there's one moment where I think Norman Bates is watching her masturbating through a keyhole. I'm pretty sure they added that one scene.
Just that one wee bit.
That's it. But I must admit, man, I don't completely hate the Gus Van Sant cycle. I don't completely hate it. It's like, it's watchable in a weird way. Like, William H. Macy, it's got some good things. It's not.
If you're putting on Hitchcock's shoes, but you need to.
Man. Like, Angus, it's some sort of artistic thing. I don't know what he was thinking there, man, but it's interesting.
I feel like I'd have respected him a lot more if he'd have made a shit film, but it wasn't a shot for shot.
If he took it and run with it, he probably should have. Because I think he's a great director. He would have probably smashed it if he did that in a way. I mean, like, did his own thing with it.
But there's a lot of shit movies we've watched, Harry, obviously, for the sack of crap. We've dug it there, but there is respect for people like that as well, though, because it's like they've done the whole process that we've been talking about this whole episode, where it's like, even just making something at all, man, like, it's fucking, it's an achievement.
I think that's most of the time we watch these films, we can find some like really fun moments in it and like bits that we actually really love. And I think that's at the end of the day, someone's made something like that you found fun and you've enjoyed the time. It's very rarely that we've watched something that's like, that was a waste of time.
I feel like the worst ones for that are ones where it's just average. It's just a plainly average movie. See if you at least commit to just this is just nonsense.
Like in 2020, I was like defiantly defending The Tax Collector, which is David Ayer's Tax Collector.
Shia LaBeouf one,
which is by all means not a great movie.
No.
But, you know, it's got a bad guy, does black magic. Shia LaBeouf's like playing like he's white, but he's doing a whole Mexican accent in the whole movie. He's playing a white American dude. It's like, I'm telling you, man, I think it's just like,
that's always been David Ayer's thing, though. That's him.
Aye, Harsh Times too. Aye, definitely. I think Harsh Times a masterpiece, though. I love Harsh Times.
He's a kind of mid director with me, where it's like he's done some terrible movies like Suicide Squad and Bright, but then End of Watch is really good.
Yeah, but I feel like he's doing stuff that's his in his lane, he smashes out of the park. Yeah, I agree. But his big budget stuff is also a wee bit.
Yeah.
What's your guys' view on Fury?
I love Fury, man. I think Fury's great, man. And I think I just think they had a great chemistry. All of those guys, John Bernthal, Brad Pitt.
LaBeouf's great in that as well.
It's controversial, but you know, Shia LaBeouf, man. Like he's an arsehole, but he's a good actor, man. He could have been something massive.
Yeah, this podcast was called in 2018, guys. this was pre any controversy.
Compare careers, but so. Jonah Hill was supposed to be the main character in Transformers, who Shia LaBeouf played, but Jonah Hill turned it down because he didn't want to get in that loop. Jonah Hill then went on to work with Scorsese, done Moneyball, done all these like art house films, but also had the big blockbuster, so he's made money and had the critical side of it. Shia LaBeouf takes the Transformers, but to me seems like he spent his entire career after trying to justify that he's not just a blockbuster actor, so he does these stunts. So he goes all the way, he gets steaming on set, he fights, he loses control.
If you watch Honey Boy, man, it's clear the dude lived a troubled life, man. Not defending him, but like, it seems like he's been through a lot in his life, man. I loved Honey Boy, I must admit, I did love Honey Boy. I forgot her name, but he wrote that, didn't he? Yeah, man, and it's Anna something, I forgot her name, but she did an amazing job directing it, and I just think I thought it was a masterpiece of film, really beautiful.
Need to watch it because he plays his dad, doesn't he?
He does, man, which I think must be one of the hardest things to do. Like, it's so impressive the way he did it. Like, he completely embodies, like, obviously this guy that's so close to him, and Yes, it's real impressive. Real impressive.
So, Predator 2.
Yeah, let's do it. You hear that, John McPhail? We're coming for you, bro.
What is better, mate?
Well, Predator 2 is better than Predator 1, I'm going to say. And also, Terminator 1 is better than Terminator 2.
Okay. Oh,
that's a good point.
That's a good controversial film opinions. Let's go for it.
This out here, man. Terminator 1 is a proper R-rated horror film. Yeah. Like, it's like non-stop violence. Anybody can die. The first 10 minutes to shoot an old woman. It's like, are you kidding me? You know what I mean? It's like, Terminator 2, it's like, okay, we've got little cute Edward Furlong, you know what I mean? He's in the back of a bike. It's like, okay. You know, but I'm telling you, man, Terminator 1 is like a non-stop, visceral, neon metropolis, ride through the night, just brutal violence. Like, I love it. Like,
What age did you see Terminator 1? Young?
Young, very young, aye.
I saw it as well, maybe, I would say under 10.
Yeah, 100%. 100%.
See when, and this is like,
I can still see the video in my head. I
remember the moment where, not because like I think the police are amazing and all that, right, but the moment where he went through the police station and started killing them, God, I was like they're not safe. It's like, no one can get to you here, they're armed to the teeth, he puts a car through and then starts shooting, and I remember being terrified at that point, like, they've got nowhere to run.
100%.
Like, how strange is that?
He massacres an entire police station. And also, man, that's James Cameron. Like, we need James Cameron to make a movie with less money and do it like a full hardcore 18 R-rated movie. That's what I want to see.
He's a master. I'll say it, man. He is a master. Like, say what you will about his later films, but he's legit. He's extremely
100%,
legit. 100%. Yeah. There's a guy on the Mark Maron podcast, right? It was a Roger Cott. Sometimes Mark Maron does like a podcast and it's like, it'll start off with someone, then it'll go into somebody else. Guest, So you had Roger Corman on for part one, and he had, he was doing like a remake of Death Race.
Yep.
It was like Death Race 2000 with Malcolm McDowell something. Mm. But he had this guy on, right? It was really interesting. Mark Maron made the point. He was done a Roger Corman version of it, but had like no money. And this guy came on, like this young boy, and he was like, he'd done like one documentary, done quite well at Sundance, and got this. And he says, all he did was complain about the limitations, and he was complaining about, we didn't have money for this. So it was a pure bitch fest for 30 minutes. Corman was on the first half hour. He's talking with James Cameron, and he was started off as a production designer. He was a truck driver, quit his job. His wife was like, you lost your mind, left her, went to LA. He was working in Corman's sets. He was to build a spaceship. He went to McDonald's, had no money, built, but got like 1,000 paper cups and painted them and made this beautiful set. Then like he stayed on. One of these things I'm sure is like he's like a pure tech kid, a science kid. And he was like, he had these worms, and he was like an assistant director, and the producers came by and he had like electric volts through them, and he would call action and put these volts on, they would move, and the producer didn't know he was doing that, and it was like, whoa, the power of this guy, he can get the worms to act and all that. So he used like every sort of disadvantage to an advantage, and he maximized every opportunity. Compare that to this wee guy who's like bitching and moaning that, oh, we didn't have money for this, and that's just like the mark of like a great director, because he just took every sort of thing that was against him and got the best out of it. So honor respect for James Cameron.
I think that's part of the fun of it, man, is it's like, especially, and it's like when people making stuff here, it's always no budget, you know, especially if you're doing a no budget feature, for fuck's sake.
But 100%.
As part of the fun of it is just try to find creative ways to get around things.
This is something I'll say on record, man. The stuff I've done with no money, I like better than anything I've done with a budget. Like, 100%. I don't know if it's doing the experience and the freedom, but I love I just, like you said, man, I mean, gets you more creative. You know what I mean?
So, not like name names or anything like that, right? But see, what would be like, what's a no budget and one you had a budget for?
Like Spiral's no budget, music video's no budget, you know, like...
So how is this? So say, for example, you've got one and there's like, there's money on the table. What's the difference then? How's a day run? Or like, what would you say is a different pressure or the structure of a day when you're shooting with a budget?
There's just more people, you know what I mean? It's like there's a lot more people. And like, man, it makes things run a lot smoother. It makes things a lot easier a lot of the time. Like, it makes things a lot easier. But just sometimes I feel like when you're backed into a corner, your mind just works a different way when you're like, well, we've no choice but to do this right now. Like we need to get this shot. What can we do? What's the best way to do it? Let's do it. When you've got the freedom and you've got people around you that can, like, I feel like you can sometimes make you, I'm not lazy, but I think there's something about the pressure of not having anything to fall back on that will like make you bring out your best self.
It's like limits your options. Like when you have money, you have a bit more on the table, about different options you can do.
Yeah, 100%.
Is there also a pressure where it's like you chose to do something and you put money behind it, or you've set something up and you don't like it on the day and you're like, I like this better? You almost feel pressure to take the first choice to prove that you're not like, I don't know if that is the case, but like say you wanted to throw something out, it's like, why did you do this scene like this way? No dialogue, or let's have them just look at each other. I always wonder that. Do they go, well, you're going off paper here, like, don't do that? No, is it not the structure as that?
Yeah, well, yeah, a wee bit of that. No, like, I'm trying to think what's my best example of that. I remember, like in Boys Night, I gave, there was a scene at an underpass, where it was kind of an altercation. And
the Billy Boys one?
Yep. And I realised that are these two young guys, like, real deal, they won't back down for this guy. So I said, I need to give him a weapon. So I got a production designer to give me a screwdriver, and I just handed it to the actor and didn't tell anybody. And I was like, so just pull this out during the scene and go for it. And he did this amazing take where he pulls a screwdriver out and he freaked out, and I was like, this is fucking great, they're amazing. And then right away, man, I've got producers around me. They're like, you can't do that. You can't, like, the cops might be on the way, you know? And I'm like, what? So that's an example, you know what I mean? Whereas, like, if that was just me with name money, you know what I mean? That may, he might have put it on my shit, who knows?
Well, for your film, Paul, I've heard that's something I've heard people ask. So it's like, oh, you know, is there anything kind of he's filmed that he didn't use and stuff? But because you'd done everything, you were the writer, producer, director, actor, DOP type thing, like you had full control, so like nothing was fluff, like everything's in the film sort of thing. That's right. But like when you've got a budget, there's the money people have inevitably got a say in what's going on, yeah. Do you know what I mean? Which is kind of fair enough, they're paying for it. So it's a kind of difficult balance with a kit. If you've got the money, you're getting a nice kit and cameras and all that, and that does help, but it's...
There's also a thing where it's like, sometimes you need the fear to kind of come up with something decent. Like definitely is, I think you ever get something filmed, it's just you need to book a day, like regardless, like obviously you need to prepare, right? But the fear will make you kind of prepare for it. Like I think you need to just book your day in and say, and then you'll come up with something decent. I think it's the same with writing. You do need like a sort of a deadline in some way to be like, I'm going to present this at this point, because like it's never going to get finished. You'll just be potting about with it for ages. I do think like just turning up on the day and like, right, what are we going to do? And you, I think, see, when you know, like, see, talking about maybe like student productions and that, and maybe it's your first thing or you've not shot anything, but you've got all these great ideas. But see, until you turn up on the day and you're like, we can't, like, you've got other people's time in your hands and you see people standing about, the fear of that, you're like, fuck, I need to have my shit together. I better have a shot list. I better know exactly what I'm doing, because people 100%. Hanging about and they're giving you their time and you've got no money, you're a prick if you do that. So you just need to have everything done to the T, I think, anyway.
Yeah.
No, absolutely. Definitely. Yeah, I'd agree with 100%. Yeah. Yeah.
So, Desert Island. He's Harry, that's your thing. Are we coming back in with us? Because they'll have I'm sure we've asked you this before.
And I'm curious enough that I can't even remember what my answer was.
Remember what you said at all. And I don't either. I'm not saying that because I went back and listened. But what are the kind of Desert Island ones you've
Desert
Island. I feel like you're better at presenting this, Harry, in a way. It's always your kind of question.
Yeah, so we usually go for a kind of, what are 3 to 5 films? Let's go with five. What are your 5 kind of films that you'd bring onto a desert island that you, the only ones you can watch for the rest of your life on that island?
You might go first.
Okay, right.
I don't mind it. Like, it's up to you. I'm going to wing it, though. I think I'm just going to...
We might inspire each other. So right,
let's
stop.
We'll go same, well, same kind of time.
Okay.
Like, one of mine's definitely True Romance. Because I think it's endlessly rewatchable. I love the performances. I just absolutely adore it. And it's a film I never get sick of watching. So I feel like that's a good one.
If I was on a desert island, I think Local Hero, because of the balance of like warmth and like community and like Scotland. And I think if I was like marooned somewhere, that's when I'd like remind me of home and like a romantic version of it. So I think Local Hero would be one of them.
Yeah, yeah. My version of that might be Orphans, just because it really reminds me of, yeah, in a darker way, the darker parts of Scotland. But my Scottish film would be Orphans probably.
Number 2, I would say The Conformist. I would say like that balance, like a total art house film. It's like one where you're like, ah, fuck, that's like cinema, that's filmmaking, like everything that's done like to the highest level. I would say The Conformist.
Yeah. And Harry, you don't know my screen right now, so if you say the word faff, I will break this screen. I will break it. Manhunter, like 100%. Like, I love Manhunter, man. Like, I think it's like, it's one of the films just creates a mood for me. Like, it really can, it's like, it's almost like taking a Valium, man. Just like how, it's like a experience, just the way it's, and it looks timeless. It looks like it was shot yesterday for a movie made in like 1986. It's amazing how good it looks. Aye, so Manhunter I just absolutely love, and I think it's just a masterpiece, and I think a lot of the themes that Michael Mann keeps dealing with, like, he really mastered on that one.
Not a non-obvious choice, but number 3, The Godfather. Like, for me, it just has to be, like, in terms of acting, everyone you've got in there. Everyone's been saying about The Godfather, so The Godfather would be number three for me.
Yep.
Original or two?
The original.
I'm the same. Actually, I prefer original to two. Look, I just love James Caan and look.
Brando, man, yeah. And fucking the Christmas scene.
100%, yeah, man. Yep.
Number four for you,
number four. I feel like I need to give Abel Ferrara a shout, man. He's like one of my heroes, man. So it's either King of New York or Bad Lieutenant. I think King of New York, man. I feel King of New York's endlessly rewatchable for me. Like, I just love, like, Larry Fishburne and that. Just fucking deals the show. He's just so cool, man. And
was it Christopher Walken says at the limo, goes, "Hey, hold this," and he's got the son off or something. Is it the funeral or something?
I know. Hey, you. And I just got one of the best scenes ever where he kills Arthur Clay. So you guys get fat while everybody's starved on the street, and it's a masterpiece. Like, I just
came from Glasgow as well.
Yes, man. There we go. You know what I mean? So yeah, Christopher Winnie walking. That's two walking movies in mine though. So I probably would like swap out one of True Romance or King of York, but I'm going to leave both of them in for now.
Number four. Fuck, man. Le Samurai, I'm going to say, the Melville film. Just think, so cool, like, in terms of, like, having, like, Paris, but then, like, stripped down, having the gangster film, very well said, but then it's got, like, this heart beneath it, and it's, like, hyper-stylized. I would say that's a good balance to have, like, the kind of warmer film, so I would say it's Le Samurai is my fourth.
I'd agree, that's a masterpiece, man. I love that movie as well. And since now we're hitting it with cool form moves, I'm going to say, Sonatine, man, like Takeshi Kitano beat Takeshi, one of my heroes. That's why I want to be the Glasgow beat Takeshi. I love Sonatine. I really think I can remake Sonatine in Greenock. I know that sounds insane, but
class,
I'm telling you, man, I think Sonatine's a masterpiece. I mean, the guy that edited my music video, Tim Curry, we watched scenes for it last night, and I'm just obsessed with that film. Like, I think the way Takeshi Kitano shoots violence, like, nobody does it. Like, that's so still, everything's like a painting and it's beautiful. So I'm going to say Sonatine.
People are snooty about remakes, man, but like that's one.
It's going to happen, man. It's going to happen, man. We're going to make it happen, guys. Let's do it. We're willing in existence here right now. It's got to be shot like a Michael Mann movie, Harry, okay?
No, good. Yeah, we'll love it.
That style would go so well with a Glasgow back. I mean, even like the music video, it's fucking like so many like great styles like Michael Mann, wasn't it? Just that the streets going out.
Oh, thank you so much. That was a goal anyway, man. Thank you so much for saying that. It means a lot, man. Thank you so much.
Number five. Fuck it, man. Return of the King.
Yeah.
Nice. Return of the King. Yeah.
I'm going to say that, man. Just adventure, the like big action bits, like great camaraderie, and it's a great, just like, because it came out at Christmas, it's just nostalgia piece as well, but fucking, how do you match that? There's not been a film to come out in terms of that scale, that action, mixed with a great horror director who can do these horrible, like, fucking, like, the real prosthetics, the physicality of it, but then have these, like, it's just that's a 10 for me, so number five.
I've been listening to that the audiobooks for Lord of the Rings recently, and it's done by Andy Serkis.
Oof,
nice.
I'm gonna watch them. I'm gonna watch them all now, the extended editions this weekend. That's my weekend's gonna be that.
I think I said it for the podcast, man, but shout out to Peter Mullen, who I think is going to be playing quite a big role in the TV show.
I've seen him in the cast list. I've not really been following that.
I must say, I don't
much,
know who he's
like,
playing, to be
like,
honest,
right.
Man. I know. I should have asked him, by the way. He was so open, but that was when, like, in between takes, John Skin, I was just like, is David Caruso sound? What's he like, man? And like, you know what I mean? And he was like, so, like, he put up with my film geekiness and David Cruz was sound. I've said that a few times now, but I just want it on the record.
You'll need to just phone him and put him on speaker with me behind you. Just be like, oh, how are you getting on, mate? Yeah, a few minutes, then go, so Lord of the Rings.
Who are you playing? I tell us, I know.
Return of the King, mate. That's part of the best trilogy of all time. Mm. I can't think of a better trilogy. Like, you've got stuff like The Godfather. The first two are excellent. There's always like the kind of wee slip up in all these different trilogies, man. Like Star Wars. Well, Star Wars is great as well, but aye, Lord of the Rings, man, nothing comes close. Like, the adventure, like, what was that? I went and seen Uncharted through the week. It's not very, it's all right, but there was something that I took for it coming out where I was just like, you don't get to see a lot of adventure movies anymore. Mm. Like, you get superhero movies and all that sort of stuff, but you don't get a lot of, like, kind of...
I'm looking forward to seeing that. I'm going to see that in the cinema, definitely.
Aye, like The Mummy, Indiana Jones, type stuff like that, where it's just like a there's a MacGuffin and everybody's kind of looking for something, and it's like a quest around the world type film.
John Carter of Mars.
Yeah.
Like, your shout out to Taylor Kitschmer, that's my boy.
He's a good actor.
Yeah, that's True Detective Season 2. Put out there, masterpiece, don't care what anybody says.
No, I'm with you on that one.
Are you actually?
True Detective crack and show, yeah, okay. I love Season 2.
Cool, okay, good. Farrell, you've won me back, Harry. You've won me back.
Colin Farrell is an underrated actor.
Yeah, yes. definitely, man. That was so cool, so good, yeah.
The one thing I was going to say about... what were you just saying there? Sorry, I totally drawn a blank. What did
the
you
trilogies?
Say?
Adventure movies.
One of the things overestimated is like, or underestimated rather, like Spielberg said this in like the 80s, and he says, somebody said like, what, everyone's so inspired by you, everybody's making your style of film, and like, what would you say, what's the big difference? And he went, they don't watch films. That's what he said. They just don't know the films. They couldn't tell the difference between an Antonioni film and a Fellini film, or like what makes them. And like, people think Spielberg is just a pot. Like, they don't realize that he's like so legit. Same with Cameron. It's like these guys know their stuff inside out, back to front, and they've been shooting since they were kids. Do you mean like? But I think a lot of time they just think, oh, you can do explosions, but there's an art to like doing the big crowd pleasers, and people just think it's an easy thing to do mainstream stuff. And it's like, you've got no idea. So like, shout out to Spielberg as well. 100%. E.T. honorable mention I'd have in my top five.
Yeah.
Well, it's like you were saying with Lord of the Rings as well, the way he balanced practical and CG, because that was always a big thing with like Star Wars, where it's like, oh, like there's too much green screen and stuff like that. And but you can, there's a place for CG. See, even in David Fincher stuff, like, see the amount of CG he actually uses, but like, you don't, he's probably one of the best for it. Like, you just pure simple shit, like, just out the windows and all that.
Zodiac, the mad, the bird's eye taxi shot. And it takes a tough turn for that, and you're like, it's just something that's happening beneath this, like Fight Club, but like, there's great, they're going underground. There's like so much good CG.
Have you heard him talking about why he does it like that? Why he has a still kind of uncomfortable camera?
No,
it's so interesting. He says it's like a God's view into what's happening. So rather than like having a ground level view, everything's shaking, everything's moving, he wants to see that the camera is always going to be there. The camera's always going to see what's happened. So whatever's happening is always, it was being determined. It's a much more unsettling way to film it. He knows the shit, man. He knows the shit.
Because I heard like Brad Pitt said something recently, and he was like, he'll be watching films with Fincher, and Fincher will just be shouting out stabilize and all that, and he's like, he's totally against the cat. Like, I love Fincher's style, but there's fucking more than one way it's going to cut, man.
No, definitely. Yeah.
No, like, good CG is when the director clearly actually works with the VFX team. Like, you get CG in a lot of films where it's like superhero stuff, like they write the fights for the films before they even write the fucking film, and then they film them all, but then it's like they'll just patch the CG on top of like something that's been shot by some director like Chloe Zhao or whatever.
They don't shoot with a CG. If you thought there was something there, like there was a plan, there was a storyboard, and they lit the scene. But I think that's why a lot of it looks CG. I've seen somebody saying, because it's just all done they make the film.
Yeah, they like plaster it on top of
respect that. Like, I think fucking know what you're going to make, first of all. Like, but even like Scorsese's used like CG brilliantly, like Aviator and all that.
Yeah, man.
I think masterpiece film, but 100%. I didn't see any difference in their ages.
See Martin Scorsese, like I sent you the photo, I've started putting up framed sort of pictures in the wall, and two out of four that I've got so far are Scorsese films. He's like one of my favourite directors.
What ones?
Taxi Driver and Goodfellas. I could not bring myself to like The Irishman. Like, I love him. I love his films, but I found myself like kidding myself on for weeks. But I liked it, and I was just like,
"No, I did feel that, like
the script's great, and I think the stuff when it's in the modern day and it's De Niro, and they're playing their own age kind of thing, that stuff's fucking amazing. I just could not get past the fucking PS2 characters, man.
The bit where
he throws the guy.
Like, that's the worst bit.
Everyone says that.
It's a slow kick. It's
annoying. See that scene? That's the scene where I reconciled with myself about Thursday's Son, and I was like, it's all right, man. Like, I done all right.
The thing is, but like, what Scorsese's mindset probably is like, he knows that this has to be done in a wide. So he'll, because even in Casino, there's like, John Favreau spoke about, there's a bit where, see, what's his missus called in Casino?
Sean Stone, what's the name? Oh, Ginger.
De Niro's holding her.
Flips the camera. I know, it's amazing.
And he keeps it in, and I never noticed it because he'd rather go with the emotion. So he knows it's like, it needs to be done like a spectacle. He needs to take him out in the street. But I think one of the big problems is that we know De Niro when he was that age, and we know what he looked like, so it's hard to conceive of him as like a de-aged version, I think. But I think just fuck it, man. The amount of money they spent on that, they should have just been like,
get young actors.
See, that's what I was going to say. Like, I love those actors as well. but it's.
But Joe Pesci at the end, but
they should
man,
have just recast.
When he's got
the horn, man, mate, it's horrible. I know.
Good when you put it in the. He's never been better, man.
I also think as we get older, when we become old men, we will have a new appreciation for the Irishman. I think it's a beautiful movie, but grown old.
Right, there's that whole thing that me and Harry have spoke about with Ridley Scott in particular. But he's since then, because we've not done this in a few years, mind you. Like we were going on a bit of a spiel where it's like he'd gone a bit kind of. What was the word, Harry?
Demented.
What was it? Alien. I was about to say the game. Covenant.
Alien Isolation.
Stuff like that. I was like, what is going on? I was like, what is going on, man? Like, this guy.
He didn't direct
master.
That, did he?
No, he did, but I'm
he's
just
not Prometheus?
Like,
no.
He directed it. I actually thought Prometheus was all right, by the way, and people pure hate that as well, but I thought Isolation was shit. There was another one that he brought out, Harry. What was the other film we were talking about? That was
I can't think.
Two movies recently now that I saw
in the
cinema.
House of Gucci.
Last Duel and House of Gucci, yeah. And the Last Duel.
Last Duel was excellent.
I've not seen Last Duel.
I thought it was good.
I'm not saying it's not excellent, but there's a moment where it holds an Adam Driver's cum face for like 40 seconds. And I'm like, what are you doing here right now, man? I'm not kidding on. Look, Adam Driver's got a great face, but.
He's legit, by the way, ex-Marine man, hoorah.
He's a cool dude. But man, look, man, Last Duel was all right. It's no Rashomon, it's all right. But there is moments in that movie, like fucking Matt Damon's mad mullet. It's like, Matt Damon's just Affleck, like, I am insulted. Yeah. I will not have this. And then this sort of thing, Ben Affleck goes from like, welcome to my castle to it's like the Boston Boston medieval France.
It's no a five star movie by any stretch, but I just mean like I'd kind of seen Ridley Scott as like this guy's getting old, man, he's on a downward trajectory, like, but it's a kind of respect to him, like bringing out even whether you like House of Gucci and Last Duel or not.
I realised I had a script sent to Ben Affleck's production company, and I just fucked that up. I know, it was an okay movie. And I must be, House of Gucci actually, I thought it was really fun.
Yeah, it was good.
I thought it was really fun. I looked Jared Leto, I really laughed a lot. I thought it was good.
I've got massive respect for Ridley Scott. Same, but
you watched Denis Villeneuve, and I think that's the new Ridley Scott. What he should be doing. That's the stuff that Ridley should be making now.
See Dune, Harry? Did you ever see it?
Nope, never got onto it, unfortunately. It's on my list.
That's excellent, man.
It's very old school Ridley Scott. Yeah. It feels like Blade Runner. It feels like the soundscape, haven't it? But I thought it was beautiful.
What are your thoughts on the original Blade Runner, Gary?
Overrated. 2049's class, I like that. I feel like I need to go back and watch the first Blade Runner. Maybe I was looking at that through the lens of like a MCU, just lens, I don't know. But I don't know, I just thought he was an arsehole in that. But no,
Harrison Ford was an arsehole?
Yeah, but I mean, he was an arsehole, that was a character, but I just preferred 2049.
Controversially, I like the voiceover.
Aye.
Everybody hates it. I actually like the noir feel of the voiceover.
I think the atmosphere and the kind of production design and all that, it's obviously amazing, the first one, but it just wasn't my cup of tea, man. But I thought the second one was class. But is that you trying to chuck me under, Harry? But it's Michael Mann's the big man in this room.
I like Ridley Scott. I just think they done a thing on a podcast, and they asked Tarantino, and it's like they do these films like this or that, and one of the ones they did was Braveheart or Gladiator. And to me, it's like Braveheart all day for all its faults, right? In terms of like accent, right? But some faults, whatever, right? Russell Crowe is like a New Zealand actor doing an English accent, playing a Spanish soldier in the Roman army. So like, that doesn't matter because it makes film sense. But the other problem is, I think, see with like Mel Gibson, the action in that is like so. Like surgical, precise. There's like a horn going through here. Yeah. There's a hammer coming on the head. There's blood. It's almost like so clinical. It's like that's proper directing. And my only problem is Ridley Scott's thing. Like I'm fucking giving Ridley Scott advice, but it's like fucking like eight cameras and you grab a shot almost on the fly. And it's like the fighting scenes are like there's some great action shots in the Colosseum, but it's almost like you just put so many cameras on it. And when it's a fight scene, you make it a scuffle, so you can't really see anything. Yeah. But with his, it's like you can see very clear action, and then you have some of that in Braveheart. And I don't know what you think about that, like just setting up cameras and just hoping for the best. But I do think, like, single camera and like having a vision, I do kind of feel that does come through. I think
Mel Gibson's a master director, I really do.
He's so good, man.
Yeah, 100%. Like, I love his films, I really do. I think he's a Apocalypto, I think, is fucking
masterpiece.
He's so legit, good. Man. He's a legit director.
And if he does Lethal Weapon 5, I will be there first day.
Is that actually happening? Yeah.
That's a rumour.
He's still in shape, by the way, man. He could definitely...
Aye, man, I think so, man. I've not seen Glover in a while, but I feel like Gibson could do it,
100%. He's definitely too old for this shit.
Yeah, 100%, I know.
Danny Glover was in the Jumanji 2 film that came out this year.
Interesting, nice.
And he's looking old.
But that's the thing. Did you not post that? And it was like, these are not the same film. And it's like that adventure film. It's just The Rock and a bench top.
That's not on, man.
Like
a clean bald head in every movie.
Fair play the action films, right? I'm not going to be a dick about it, but at the same time, like, fucking come on, man. Pure homogenized film.
Brendan Fraser, who's in Glasgow now, I think, still. He got his career stolen, man. That was his.
Off The Rock, you say?
Aye, not by The Rock, but he took it over. Aye, that could have been him, man.
Did he not get his back broke because he got hung in The Mummy? But he genuinely broke his back. I can't believe that happened, man. Because he had seen people were criticizing he put on weight and all that, but like his back broke. It's like, fuck me, man.
Is he not in the new Scorsese film, actually?
Yeah, The Flowers of the Summer. Yeah.
I'm excited to see that. My Flowers of the Killing Moon or something.
That's got like a $200 million budget. Yeah. Why?
De Niro broke his leg on it, apparently. Did he? I think. Had to send him home. But anyway, man, also shout out to Michael Keaton. If you're in Glasgow and you see this, hit us up.
He's the man.
Yeah, we'll take you for dinner, man. We love you, Keaton.
Come to the premiere. Angry Young Men.
He's the man. He's... What an actor, man.
Unbelievable, man.
See the other guys, man. He is the funniest... Have you seen the other guys?
It's such an understated kind of comedic performance. Yeah. It's class.
The bit where he's like, how you doing, Gene? He goes, I'm good. He says something, he's giving a speech and he goes, I'm working here and Bed Bath & Beyond. I'm trying to earn enough money to put my son through NYU so he can become a DJ and explore his bisexuality. It's absurd line, man.
It's just every time it goes to him and they catch him like mid-phone call about stuff, and it's always just pure bizarre shit, talking to like Sister Claire or something like that.
he's amazing, man.
Yeah, he's class.
He's a master, man.
Pacific Heights.
Not seen that.
It's great. It's Michael Keaton doing Psycho with Melanie Griffiths and Matthew Modine. They rent out a flat to him and... he's just a total psychopath. It's amazing. It's Michael Keaton Unhinged, which is great. Night Shift. Ever seen Night Shift? Norman Howard movie?
No, not seen that.
It's Henry Winkler and Michael Keaton pimping ladies out of a mortuary. And it's a comedy masterpiece, man. Like, I can't stand by it enough. Like as far as like 70s, early 80s maybe, masterpiece.
That sounds class.
I think it may be Michael Keaton's first film, actually. Maybe his first big proper film.
After SNL, because he was like a stand-up, wasn't he?
Was he in SNL? I didn't realise
it. I think he was.
That's interesting. I don't know.
I've not seen it anyway, but...
Michael Keaton, man, hit us up, bro. Take us for dinner. Definitely. Take us to La Terna. Seeing you all there.
You can wear the bat suit, mate.
Aye, wear what you want.
You want.
I'll wear the bat suit, bro, whatever you need.
How about him coming back to do that, man? That's... What age is he now? Is he, you know, what, 70? But he doesn't look it. I'm sure I looked it up recently. And
is he
like,
70? It could be.
He's getting old, man, but he does not look it. He does not look a day over 50.
Do you want to get nuts? Let's get nuts.
It's kind of wild, man. Yeah. But have you got anything else, Harry, you want to add?
I'm interested. What's your two? If you can do a quick one, what's your two Desert Island Discs then?
12 Angry Men's one of them.
Nice.
I think that's just a class, sort of moral quandary movie. It's A Wonderful Wife has to be there as well. That's always my Christmas movie, but it's just such a great sort of feel good. I mean, the guy's on the brink of suicide, so that's obviously so kind of darker, but like...
Me and my girlfriend went to see it in the cinema. Yeah. She's off screen right now, but I had to hide my tears and she was like a little robot not crying. I was like, what's wrong with you?
I cry more every year, mate. I was like swallowing, and I'm like, I'm cool.
Just falling back lumps just, of tears.
It's like the title says, man. It's such a fucking beautiful film about like the importance of just like thinking that everything you do is menial, whatever. But I think there's got to be an animated one in there.
The Iron Giant is for you.
You said that before I even did, Terry. I think that's the best Superman movie that's ever released.
The remake, but it's like you're taking that eternal story and...
Yeah, like Tarantino, I think, said that about Unbreakable, which is also class. That wouldn't be in my Desert Island. That's a class film, but he's like, that's his favourite Superman movie, but it's like the same kind of thing with Iron Giant for me. Like, I've not... Like, the whole moment where he flies up to like stop the nuke is just like the best sort of fucking Superman moment. So what else? Jump in, Harry, because I feel like they got the break of going one to each other. You've just left me drowning here. Yeah,
top three, Harry. Yeah. Fantastic. Percy, was it Percy Jackson was the one you said the last time?
And the Lightning Thief, Fantastic Four, Shang-Chi. Transformers 1 through 3. Shang-Chi, my God. Yeah. No, I'll see. Have a think.
The Shining.
Yes.
I think as well. Kubrick's nice. a big director name for me, but that's his best one. And then... Oh, man.
It's hard on the spot. Every film you've ever seen, it's like up to the jukebox, man. Forget everything you've ever heard.
I feel like I'm filling the, it's like one spot left, but Goodfellas is right, one
I was waiting for Scorsese, you need to throw Scorsese in.
Goodfellas is just...
Well, I'm surprised I left Scorsese out of mine, actually.
It used to be top 100, didn't it, man?
I know, that's it. And too many is like that, like, it's hard just to pick one anyway, they're all fucking so good.
Oh, now you're back, Harry. Yeah.
I'm back, yeah.
You left me drowning here. You left me drowning. it's got to be Goodfellas, man. That's just, it's a fucking classic. What's that to say, man? Like, that's his best film.
It's a masterpiece.
Yeah, what a casual man, nae foreign films, but there's a few black and white ones, Harry, so there you go.
So you talk about his best film, there's a well good bit in the, I think it's like the first series of Sopranos, and like Michael Pirelloni is going at the club, and it's like Marty comes in and he goes, Marty, Kundu, I liked it!
It's so good, I know.
So funny, man. Yeah, a lot of obscure films, I liked it!
But that whole shot as well, man, where it's just going into the club with like Henry Hill, his partner, just goes through everything. Like, how you fucking orchestrate something like that, man, like where that amount of people just...
Nice, masterful.
I think that's something that's kind of lost now in modern stuff, like a lot of the time, what you need, a lot of, I keep bringing up the superhero thing, but that's what keeps coming out, all the stuff that comes out, but like, something I was saying to Harry the other week, I've noticed watching a few of the more recent ones, like there's never extras. And it's such a, like, I was saying about how they're the scum of the earth on a set, but it is kind of strange when you're watching something and there's big battles going on and there's no stakes because... You don't really think about the extras, obviously, but like it's part of the whole sort of set of things and all that. But you don't get, you know, the big Ben Hur type films now where you've got like they've brought like 10,000 people off the street to get involved. Yeah. Kind of like
not an extra, but talking about Braveheart again, Peter Mullen in that
amazing.
Do you mean like that just humanizes the army?
David McKay, man, David McKay, definitely. Both of them are great, 100%.
And that humanizes the full army. It's like, what's he saying? Like, that can't be him. And it's like, you almost give them that wee aside, and it's not just a repeated CGI, like, we'll take the first 10 and multiply them. Do you mean it's like, that's somebody, a human? It's like, why are we fighting for these people? Do you mean
100%.
It's like, we're heading home, like that. Just, that's like, you'll never get, like, I don't know if you'll never, but like having that, a film of that scale with like real extras and like using army reserves and all that. But one thing I saw just quickly on, is it Scarlett Johansson film? No, it's nothing to do with her, but they had like a scene of her and Florence Pugh doing a short reverse shot, and it was green, it was blue screened.
Yeah.
And in the background was just a cafe. And it's like, but I don't know what they were saying. It's something to do with like, because CG's not unionized and they can just like, they can work all hours.
Yeah.
But I thought, people sitting in like, you could do that in a closed set. Like, what's the point?
Breaks
your heart, man.
Yeah. Right, Harry, you've got your five. Go. Now you're on the spot and you're not getting a break in between any of them.
All right, let's go for it. I'm going to go with Mulholland Drive I absolutely love it. And I know, Gary, you don't like it, but I think it's David Lynch has got some, it just speaks to me. I love his weird stuff. I love it.
I've come round to Mulholland Drive, actually, Harry, I'll give you. And Lost Highway is a good one as well.
I like Lost Highway,
What's the one with Willem Dafoe? Is that Lost Highway?
Yeah, Wild at Heart.
Wild at Heart, yeah, okay, that's another one, actually. One of many Nicolas Cage films. I'm not putting that on the list, but I just like that film. Fincher. I need to do a Fincher film. Maybe Zodiac.
Mm. Yeah, man.
Or Panic Room?
That's an interesting choice, yeah.
Yeah, Panic Room. I'm going to go with Panic Room. Can I get a script of Heat to use as fire?
Oh my God, how dare you.
What about Women Under Influence? I like that one, Harry.
Yeah, man. I love Women Under Influence, man.
Oh, that's got to be an honorable mention.
Yeah, man.
No, I was going to say, that was going to be one of them as well. I absolutely love that film.
It's great, man. Chinese Book, honorable mention as well.
You seen Mikey Nicky? Mikey Nicky?
No, I haven't, no.
It's an Elaine May movie starring Cassavetes and Peter Falk, but it's a masterpiece, man. You need to watch it.
I think the way Cassavetes does, like, chaotic dialogue,
it's so good.
It's so good, man, where it's just, like, like uncut gems.
Safety balls have kind of got that vibe, definitely, 100%.
Well, here's something I'll agree with you, Harry, and it's something that maybe ties in. In Cassavetes' film, I'll say there is bits you could cut, but yep, the power comes from not cutting it.
Yep.
The way he'll Chinese bookie and backstage just sitting. There's shots you could be like, what's going on here? Yep. But there is an added power. It doesn't always work. Like, I don't think it always works in every single take, but it does give it a mad power when you don't just say, right, we've got what we need, cut, go away. Do you mean?
Yeah, that? I think that's what Cassavetes does so well, especially when we're under the influence, is when the scenes that are the length of them makes it more uncomfortable. I know that's adds to the kind of theme of the scene. I think that's so well done in Women Under the Influence.
So what else?
That's three I've done in that.
Yeah.
Let's see. I just had one in my head. What was it? Merowitz with stories.
Oh yeah.
Interesting.
That one. I just love the writing in that. I love Adam Sandler. I love Ben Stiller and that and Dustin Hoffman as well was fantastic.
Punch him in the nose.
I think that's a good one. Yeah. I'm gonna have to go with some big schlock. What am I gonna do?
George of the Jungle, mate. It's got to be
Predator.
These are all quite hard films. I need to have something that makes me like cry laughing. Talk amongst yourselves. I'm gonna have a think.
George of the Jungle and A Woman Under the Influence are the ones for me where I've packed them. Oh, I thought I packed them for the island, but they've been left behind in the house.
George of the Jungle, Brendan Fraser.
Oh man,
really?
Okay, I've got it. Evil Dead 2, that is my last one. Okay. That's my five. I think I'm going to go with that.
Over Army of Darkness? You'd go Evil Dead 2?
Yes, I think Evil Dead 2 is an absolute masterpiece. Army of Darkness as well. I like all the Evil Dead films, even the remake, that's a cracking one.
I like the remake, I thought the remake was really well done. I thought it was a good movie,
Really quite scary actually, like a really tense, bloody horror film. You don't see very many of like that kind of style anymore. But that's my five.
Excellent. Man.
Tree rape, guys. Don't get much tree rape in movies anymore.
Tree rape?
Yeah.
Jesus.
Evil Dead staple.
I think we'll wrap it up on that.
Yeah, sorry, guys.
That's been a bit 2 hours, I think, man. Nonsense. But that was good, guys. Thanks for coming on.
No, thanks for having us, guys.
Long time guest of the show. So.
Yeah. You guys want to pitch your films one last time so we have a retweet, remember?
Yeah. Let's plug the stuff. Starting with you, Paul.
Angry Young Men, Thursday, 10th of March, 3:15. Devil tickets left, come see it. I don't know what's going to happen after that, but come along.
Yeah, man, the Skin, Glasgow Film Festival, I think it's 5:30, same day, March 10th. I think the overlap, man, mad, like, go see Angry Young Men, do not come see Skin. Skin will be on the telly anyway, so like, Skin's going to be on BBC4, so don't worry if you miss it. And Infectious Nihilism, March 27th, Sunday, I think it's 3:30 at the Glasgow Short Film Festival, CCA. So I, man, come see it, come hang out with us, buy his drinks, and we'll have a laugh.
Be there, man, that's a belter, definitely.
Definitely.
Can vouch.
And a big shout out to Paul at the Green Room for having us here today. It's an excellent setup, got the Joe Rogan mics and whatnot. I could definitely not have set this up in my bedroom. So
no, I love
thanks
this
very
one,
much.
Aye, definitely, thanks, Paul.
Thank you, Paul.
Legend.
Right. And Harry, you got any, give us a bloody plugs, mate.
All right, thanks for listening, everybody. We're on Twitter and Instagram at Real Filthy Podcast or something like that. I'm on Twitter at Dry Cthulhu.
I'm on Twitter at Sack of Mac.
Are also on Spotify, iTunes, anything you find your podcast. Give us a like, give us a share, give us a favorite, give us a review, tell us how crap we are. Guys, do you want to plug your social media or no? Do you like?
Marlow
Films, Pricey Films on Instagram, and PriceyFilms.com is my wee website.
Nah, you've got all your
Have
stuff
you got
on
your
there,
shorts you? On there?
Everything. Yeah, most of the shorts are on there, man. Yeah, Infectious Nihilism isn't on there yet, but I think that'll be online after the Glasgow Short Film Festival. I think you can pay for it online at the Edinburgh Book Festival website. And you see a Q&A with me and Graham as well with that one. But so pricefilms.com.
Cool. Right, I'm away to go work in the St Mirren game, Harry. I don't know what you're up to, mate, but...
Right. I'm going to faff. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to do a Michael Mann and faff.
I think you need to do a rewatch.
Yeah, man.
With a Pricey's rant in the backyard.
Yeah, can you record like just an angry audio commentary?
Yeah, happily. I'm going to go home and do that right now.
Well, it's like a Ben Affleck commentary at Armageddon.
Yeah, definitely.
All right, thanks everybody.
Thank you.
You're a legend, Harry, man. Thank you so much.
Cheers for listening, guys. Bye.